Şimdi ikinci konuşmacımızı davet edeceğim. Tabii kendisini tanıtmaya çok gerek yok. Karaciğer cerrahisinde dünyaca tanınmış expert bir cerrah aramızda, Profesör Guido Torzilli. Özellikle parenkim koruyucu cerrahi ve ağır bir vasküler cerrahilerle bir devrim yaratan bir konsepti geliştirdi kendisi. Bugün de intraoperatif ultrasonografi ile ilgili bir ders verecek bize. Kendisini davet etmek istiyorum. Yes, Professor Torzilli, would you please come to... Thank you.
Thank you very much. Sorry for the translation for my bad English. And fortunately, it cannot be translated from Italian. So, and thank you very much for the kind presentation, because it was translated also for me, and too kind. And my talk will be just to an overview on the technical issues of intraoperative ultrasonography during liver surgery. I have no disclosure. And to understand the sense of doing intraoperative ultrasound in liver surgery, I think we have to, otherwise, ultrasound is essentially something that help us, at least in the common sense, in staging the disease better than the preoperative imaging. But formally, for the conventional surgery, is not really essential, I mean, for a right hepatectomy or whatever. The real tricky point is that ultrasound is the way, at least initially, and still now actual for me, to change our way of, to infect the surgeon in his perspective, looking at the complex organ as the liver is. The surgeon, without the ultrasound, at least without using the ultrasound as a surgical tool, think about the liver in two ways, like a book or a Swiss cheese. The book means you generally, when we do conventional surgery and look at the classification of the hepatectomy, the conventional hepatectomies, you are dissecting the liver vertically towards the caval, according to the hepatic vein, according to the formal anatomy, and what can be disclosed by in the surface, just clamping the pedicle accordingly to the right side, left side, the artery, the vein, and whatever. Then in this way you will drive your surgery in 8-9 kind of operation, which is an underestimating the possibility that you have for the liver. On the other hand, in this way, of course, when you do this surgery, and this can be done easily at least, in laparoscopy, and I may say that in the minimal access liver surgery, there has been, at least initially, an excessive use of over-resection rather than sparing. The only thing that was spared, at least initially, was the skin, not the liver, because it was easier to divide into two parts, and this is the case of the robotic, the liver. So the risk of, initially, was we are losing the concept of the complex parenchyma sparing. This is what I am threatened by, the evolution of some courses of surgery, especially in the western side of the world. Thank you to the Japanese, now we are doing also complex hepatectomy in laparoscopic environment in a parenchyma sparing way. So you skip the complexity. If you divide vertically, you know, don't care about the bifurcation of the portal vein or whatever. But you, of course, limit your solution. And you increase the risk of surgery, because you remove a lot of liver, sometimes useless. The other aspect is the Swiss cheese. Swiss cheese, many colleagues of mine has always said, you do the Swiss cheese surgery. Swiss cheese surgery does not need the ultrasound. Any surgeon that is facing with a normal liver, you can palpate the hardness of the tumor, and you can remove quite safely the tumor in the peripheral portion of the organ. Then you do this surgery, but peripherally. Then what you are skipping, it's you face only with low and medium complexity. But with US, in reality, as it was well shown by my colleague, you have the possibility to make transparent the organ. Then to know what there is inside and to check where the differences, the variation, whatever, the relationship, and then thinking about something different than this just resection, but also complex, just not a wedge resection. And it's a surgical policy if you elevate the ultrasound in this sense. You are talking about something different. It's a modality that changed your way to deal with the liver. Then there are other aspects which are important, at least for the open. Some part of the use of ultrasound is we have achieved so high complexity to be faced in a conservative way that still now is for the open, and you will see at the end the video, for the open approach. But now the duty is try to find a different burden between the minimal access and the open access. Then there are other things that has to be considered when you are doing this kind of surgery, because you are facing with a different three-dimensional view of the organ. And the ultrasound, of course, is the main argument. We have to consider three main phases: the exploration, the guidance, and the control of what you have done. The exploration, basic principle, modality, tricks. I will move a little bit faster. Well, once you, if you don't have this kind of OR, US system should stay in this point, in the open surgery, because the surgeon has not to turn back to look at the ultrasound and then have two visual orientations which are not the same among the surgical field and the ultrasound. And you immediately realize when the radiologist is doing that, because the radiologist position always these instruments here, like at the bedside in the world. The second aspect is the probe. The probe has to be a probe that offers a wide scanning, but a small size to enter in the all the part of the operative field in which you need. The modality. You have to start exploring the liver initially just when you have mobilized the falciform ligament and exposed the surface. You don't have to dissect the caval confluence, for example, because otherwise you insert artifacts like the hair due to the dissection, which may mask the anatomical details. The initial exploration is important, and at least in our perspective, and I will motivate this reason, you have to use the portal branch as a driver. Why? And this is the position in which you have to start, which is in the middle part of the liver, in the crossing in on the middle hepatic vein, grossly, at the bifurcation, in between the fourth segment and the right anterior portion. Grossly at this point, you will see this, but don't fix exactly with the point. You have to always think about what you are seeing, and because there are variation, constitution different. Then from this point, with an ultrasound probe with mid-low frequency, not the high frequency, then there should be a wide frequency of exploration, because with the mid-low you have the panoramicity, you can see on the deep, but if you have 10 megahertz you just see the first part, and then you get lost because you do not recognize the anatomy of the organ, which will drive your exploration. But it is enough to tilt upward and downward and on the main axis. And from this point, following the portal branch, you are sure that you are exploring all the segments of the organ. And you know, there is a difference. Henri Bismuth was saying you have to follow the patty vein. This is the French school. But the inventor of ultrasound is Makuchi, follow the portal branch. I trust the master, although I respect, of course, Professor Bismuth. And then you have to, just from that point, you explore the right anterior, you move to the right posterior, then you move to the left, to the four superior, four inferior, segment two, segment three, and segment two. Once you have arrived here, you will start looking at the patty vein. But before understanding why we should follow the portal branches, there is this example, which I used to show. This is a tumor, right side at ultrasound of the right hepatic vein. It is bulging the right hepatic vein. It's also considering no, it was not infiltrated, it was just compressed. Well, according to the normal picture, this is segment 7. But it's strange, but the tumor thrombus from this tumor was in segment 8. P58 was occupied by the tumor thrombus. Why? Because the cranial part of the liver, in a three-dimensional consideration, you have always to think that it's a three-dimensional organ, the P08 dorsal is passing above like an arch over the right hepatic vein. So on the right side of the right hepatic vein, if you follow the portal branch, you will delineate the segment 8 dorsal. It's an important issue. Once you have explored the liver, you remember segment 2 and 3, you will find the hepatic vein at the caval conference. And then this is the typical bifurcation, but it was already disclosed better than me. And this is the position of the probe. You have done all the, you circumnavigate according to the portal branch of the liver, you arrived here, and now you are here. Once you are there, you tilt the probe downward and you will explore the segment 1, the paracaval portion, the caudate lobe, according to the roof delineated by the three hepatic veins. There is an imaginary roof composed by this. And once you go down, you bend down, sometimes, in 20% of the cases, you will encounter a thick vein from the IVC, but this is not the right hepatic vein. Is the accessory, the princess of the accessory vein, is the inferior right hepatic vein, which is running behind the right posterior, right portal vein and the right posterior. And this is the peculiarity. You will never see the right hepatic vein in this position. This is the right, there is also the middle inferior right and whatever, but. The tricks, we have something that is added to our exploration to improve our capability to stage the disease, in example, like the contrast. We were the group that initially started to use the contrast intraoperatively. We did not devise the contrast enhanced ultrasound. We just brought the idea in the OR. It was not a great innovation, but in the OR, we were the first group. And it was very useful, either for the METS than for the ACC. We classify the pattern according to the presentation for the ACC to differentiate. For the ACC, it was essentially a differentiation of the nodules rather than the detection, because it's the arterial phase with the sonoview. Sonozoid is different, but there are two contrasts. But with the sonoview, which is the one available for us, it's more difficult because the time of the exploration is 3-5 minutes. And for the contrast, for the metastasis, nowadays we use in the multiple bilobar setting the use of the contrast, especially when the in the ultra the lesion are isoechoic and multiple. In this sense, still now, despite the proficiency of the MRI with the hepatospecific contrast agent, there is a benefit of using the contrast. The biliary tract, as it was said, of course we can explore also the biliary tract in when it is not dilated. Just when you are at the position to look at the portal bifurcation, upward slightly, because the biliary tract is running on the dorsal part. And you will see, in this with the green, you know, just tilt upward, and you will see, like in this schema, look, this is the portal bifurcation, as you can see, and you see a lot of ducts. Why? Because the confluence of the biliary tract is centripetal compared to the bifurcation of the portal branch, which is the problem, especially when you have a CAT scan, no? Because they are all at the centrum. It's the reason why we have to do major hepatectomy for the CLAXIN. CLAXIN, not CLAXIN, it's CLAXON. Sorry, this is the stupid eye, the disturbing watch, eye watch. And sometimes you can recognize important variation, as it was shown before, like this one, the left bile duct, the B58, and the posterior that is running in the left bile duct, and the common bile duct. We use the ultrasound when we do. We have never done a cholangiography for the CLAXIN or any biliary resection in our series. We'll try to publish, but the reviewer, as always, now it's 20 years of experience without any problem. So it's it's useful. We do not ask the radiologist, the technician, to come and do whatever you want. You can inject just air in the bile duct, and you will see, in depending on the strength, I mean, if you force too much, you will have something different. But if you force slowly, the hair mix up with the bile juice. And you will see the anatomical details much better then. It's a contrast, cheap, because it is only hair, so it's very easy. And once we do the reconstruction after this is a left-sided trisectionectomy, for a CLAXIN tumor, stage 4, we had to tilt the left hepatic artery to reconstruct the right posterior. And at that time, at the end, you have two segments. You want to know that the stump is the stump of the two segments. Otherwise, it's a problem, only two segments without biliary drainage. You just inject, force it, don't care about the injection. And suddenly the hair spread out in the liver, you are sure that this anastomosis will work as you wanted, draining all the part of the liver. And the other aspect which is very important is the communicating vein. This aspect is what has changed our surgery. This is the picture of the paper of Makuchi showing with the inferior right hepatic vein the possibility that you had. It was the first paper showing that if there is a variant, anatomical variant, you can skip the right hepatectomy. You can do something different. The first paper about complex parenchymal pain surgery is emotional because it was published on surgery, gynecology, and obstetrics. Nowadays, the name of the journal is Journal of American College of Surgeons. It does not exist anymore in that fashion. And this paper was a master. This is the picture in which the patient was done this resection, and all the people that mentioned this operation always forget to mention the original paper that motivated all the others. I drive crazy. And this was because there was the inferior right. But there is another possibility. In many patients, the majority, and we have proven on British Journal in 2010 this fact, when it is occluded or heavily obstructed, the vein, the liver adapts. It's not a sudden occlusion, it's low occlusion, because the tumor compress, and at the end, then deliver a data and develop the communicating vein in between the hepatic veins. Then it offers you a further solution. You can resect just the part, despite you are cutting, amputating the hepatic vein. This opened completely new scenarios. These are communicating veins in between the middle and the right, very well evident. At the end, we resect only segment 8 and 7, and all part of the liver. This is the schema was in the patient. And the other aspect is the fusion imaging. Nowadays, you can combine intraoperatively the preoperative or pre-chemo imaging of the patient with the intraoperative ultrasound on the same screen. You have this adapter to pull up. These are two different companies. And you can, first of all, educate better the surgeon, because I understand the surgeon, the liver surgeon knows the preoperative imaging, otherwise cannot be a liver surgeon. But sometimes has difficulty with the intraoperative ultrasound. If you put together the two images in scanning, which are exactly mimicking what you are looking at with the ultrasound, you learn each other by the imaging compared. And the other aspect for this fusion imaging is the disappeared lesion. If you do a parenchyma sparing lesion and you do not amputate the organ, like ALPS or two-stage, you don't do this, you put the pre-chemo image CT on the ultrasound with a CD, very cheap. Just the ultrasound, you insert the CD in the ultrasound machine and you have the two images. And they combine together, and then you identify the area in which the lesion is. And then you can remove, even though you don't see the lesion, in a parenchyma sparing fashion, the tumors. In this patient, we removed 18 lesions. The guidance, of course, and the guidance is you have to delineate the resection area, dissection guidance, and some tricks. Resection area, move fast. Just a simple, this is the classic, maneuver, finger, electrocautery. With a stable probe, you can do that with one hand and insert the electrocautery, and that's okay. And this, of course, can be done also in laparoscopy. Sometimes you have a complex condition like this one. We are doing a scanning which is from posterior inferior to anterior, tilting the liver, because we want to resect in a conservative way a cholangio which was invading the right hepatic vein, but there were collaterals, and we need just this small resection, and the patient is after 5 years free of disease, and she is enjoying her own life, a young woman. Dissection guidance, gores or just the clots and the hair facing the cut surface, then you know where you are going. Sometimes it is useful not to use the gores, because the gores mask the liver, and after that, if you just use the gores, in this way, it sometimes is useful to check again, because sometimes you may leave some disease, then you have to correct the dissection. In this patient, we were removing 25 lesions. Of course, these aspects works also in laparoscopy, and the philosophy should be exactly the same. Tricks, but Professor Turundo will talk about that. The anatomical resection with the ultrasound, you can, the anatomical resection of the segments was started thanking to the introduction of the ultrasound in the 70s. Why? Because we may imagine the line which is dividing anatomical part of the liver, but we do not recognize them. Then we have two chances, the ultrasound system or the Takasaki technique, very popular in laparoscopy now, entering from the ilium to the varus pellicle, doing the speleologist. And in example, the middle parting vein, usually the surgeon that they asked me, please, when I was coming in the various war, can you tell me where is the country line? It's impossible to see where is the country line just looking at a patty vein. And even if you contact, look at the IVC, the country line can do like this. It's not like this. But only having one landmark, you have infinite lines that are passing through. So it's nonsense. You just know where is it, but you don't know if this is the anatomical plane. Two, three different versions, and you always see the middle hepatic vein. Then for the anatomy, because the anatomy is this one, you need something else, and this was the first release, Makuchi, in the 70s, the injection. And think about, this was done to substitute the fluorescence. Now the word fluorescence. But at that time, he injected the dye because with the fluorescence they couldn't see the segment. There were not technology enough. Then now happens the opposite, no? Nowadays with the fluorescence. Anyhow, the system is always this. The only problem is very difficult to inject in the vessel because the vessels are small. Then we introduce the compression. The compression works, it's completely reversible, does not damage anything, you don't have to go into the liver like a speleologist. Of course, nowadays it works essentially in an open surgery. And I may say that this is a critical point. This is segment 7 and 8 dorsal resection. And nowadays also with the fluorescence, with the compression, you use the flow compression in a counter the compression approach. This is a nice case in which we had a thrombus, but the P5 was open. We clamped the artery, and then we inject the ICG, and the segment was completely seen in a counter staining fashion. And this can be done also avoiding the dissection of the pedicle for the sectionectomy. But this probably is the past unless we will not find a way, and we started to do compression also in laparoscopy, like in this case. And the last aspect is the hooking. The trick of the hooking is once you don't know which vessel is, like in this case, this is eight ventral. You pull up the vessel, you check on the ultrasound, and if the vessel that you have pulled and circled is the one that it moves and you recognize the anatomical fashion, is not P5 but is P8 ventral, because if you cut P5, you extend the resection uselessly to a right anterior sectionectomy from an intended segment 8 resection. And then you do the resection. And now we have reported our series of this technique also in laparoscopy. We are moving, trying to move the conservativeness also in the laparoscopic environment. The control, of course, at the end, when especially there are small lesions, you try to identify in the specimen to be sure that you catch the lesion that we were planning to, or you can also check on the cut surface if there was a lesion remaining, like in this case. The incision, for the open approach, the chest is important because you do the liver hanging and you surround the liver, and it is so important that it was also introduced according to the same approach in the laparoscopic environment to push the minimal invasive surgery on the liver. And in this way you have the chance also to control and do dissection, otherwise unfeasible, like in this case in which the tumor was just in this fossa, where the inferior vena cava was just in this fossa, but we didn't do any resection of the major hepatic vein. And this was the canyon in which the tumor was This was the image at the intraoperative ultrasound of the shrinked hepatic vein. Left surgeon hands is fundamental. In laparoscopy it could be a force, but you need something behind if you do want to do a resection and you are not, you don't get lost during the sections, because this is reminding at any time where you are going, and if you, where you are going is where you want to go. And then you keep the finger here, mobilize the liver enough, and drive the resection. This is very useful for the complexity of the resection. Look, this is a patient with an operation that was a tunnel at the end. There were a cascade of tumor in segment 8 and 1. And then with this incision, you should do like this with the finger. So you should be Mr. Fantastic of Fantastic Four. But with the chest, you have pulling up the liver, you have a straight access, like in this way, to the position of the tumor, and at the end you do liver tunnel, like in this way. Where to go? Finished. We want to sculpture the organ, and this is essential to do so. We have moved our evolution in the operation from the mesopatectomy to the tunnel, in example, but we have done up to now really a lot of new operation that has been described in the literature. They are reproducible. This is the number of operations that are done by my staff, and my staff from this year to this year became completely autonomous in this surgery. Liver tunnel or whatever, can be exported. This is Urbani in Pisa. It is an upper transversal, one of the operations that we devised. And these are courtesy of several surgeons that has done similar operation, and I'm sure that also my friend Professor Durudo can do that. Then if you want to move from this to this, and up to now we don't know if we can do that in a laparoscopic fashion, ultrasound is essential. Thank you very much for your kind attention.
Thank you very much. It was very, yani çok etkileyici bir sunumdu. It was very exhilarating lecture. Shall we continue with the video? Because there is another topic. Bir başlığımız daha var, video sunumuna ait örnekler. Onu da toplantıyla beraber devam edelim, zaman kaybetmeyelim diye.
Sorry, but it was asked to me to introduce also a video about this kind of surgery. I think that it will be interesting to see what I will discuss tomorrow. Torsilio. I don't know why it stopped. Anyway, this is the video of a patient with liver cyst and multiple focal bilobar lesion. There was a right colorectal cancer and multiple liver disease. This was the CEA, and the patient had 7 cycles of FOLFOXIRI plus bevacizumab with downsizing of the primary tumor and stable disease in the liver with the belowing the CEA. We can a little bit move further. There will be the imaging. And there is the comparison of the preoperative EOB MRI in two phases to show the cyst on the one side and the cyst plus CLM in the left side. There were 36 mets and 17 cysts. And you will see how the imaging nowadays may play a role in helping us to do advanced surgery in these cases. We do always the virtual cast, and with the virtual cast we have a nice estimation of the liver volume, because in a complex procedure it would be difficult to estimate the liver volume. Nowadays we know that we can leave 42% of the liver in this patient in a single operation. You see in green the metastasis, and the remnant liver is the one that is remaining solid. This is the scheduled operation. Of course, we study the patient intraoperatively, you know, right anterior. This is the gallbladder, all the lesions. This is the right hepatic vein, cyst, right posterior. Then we will move on the, this is a cover confluence of the left side with the tumor here behind the cover confluence. And so the complexity was quite high. The operation is run with the, this is the division of the Makuchi ligament, taping the left hepatic artery originating from the gastric, and then the cover confluence with the encirclement of the common trunk. And then after we will cut the inferior right. There was an inferior right. And we encircled the right hepatic vein. This was opened because we gripped the liver better. We demarcated the area. There is the with the ultrasound, and we delineate with the ultrasound the resection area. This is the distribution. With the, this is done on the video, not in the OR. Just to. So this was the resection area that we were planning. Three large resection areas. Then we start the dissection with the largest one. We use the ligature now because we have the recovery fund of the European community, so we can spend money. This was one pedicle. This is another pedicle for the segment 8. This is the right hepatic vein, which is appearing, which has been detached. Then we move on still medially, segment 8, and then we are approaching the middle hepatic vein. You see here the middle hepatic vein. The right hepatic vein is where there is this finger here. We are detaching the vessel here, pedicle. This is a branch of the middle. At the end, we have encircled the left and the common and the scissural vein because there was a tumor which was bulging behind. And then we detach in an R1 vascular fashion the vein. We had to do a partial resection of the vein because the, one part of the vein couldn't be detached. Then we did a partial resection and direct suture with proline.
running suture, it's okay. So here we did a sort of tunnel, mini tunnel on the left side. And at the end we finish the resection, and then we start with the inferior part. Then we, in this way, we just amputate, but we have to preserve the segment you will see, the branching pattern of the segment 8 dorsal and 8 ventral, because there was a lesion just in between the two vessels. And we want to spare this part of the liver, 42%, so it was essential. Especially you will see, when you will see the CT 6 months after, the reason why it is useful to spare that liver. And at the end, you know, this is the tumor which was detached, this is the pedicles, these are the pedicles to the segment 5, this is 8 dorsal, 8 ventral. This surgery is useful with the ultrasound, but at the end you follow the vessel. So there are two guidance. The anatomy, if you have in your mind and experience, this is the hooking, to be sure that you are ligating the right side, the segment 5. You don't want to damage anything, because if you damage something, the operation may shift to the formal amputation, and the liver may be not enough. Then you continue, you are almost finished the resection. And this is the right hepatic vein, the middle hepatic vein, the left hepatic vein, there is a tunnel here. This is 8 dorsal, 8 ventral, P5 stump, P5-8. And this is the left side resection. These are 36 lesions which were removed. And the operation was this one, no complication, 300 milliliters in hospital stay 15 days. $775 milliliters, the estimated one, so it was reliable. This is the CT scan 6 months after surgery. And look, the right liver, the one that you left, we left just the specimen, is this big part. It was just a slice. So you induce growing of the liver in a physiological way if you keep the vessels. Thank you very much.